A warm welcome to one and all. Myself Kunal Chowda and my colleague Saili Pawaskar from second year BR students of Srimati KL Tiwari College of Architecture take this opportunity to introduce you to our organization and institution. I shall now hand it over to Saili to introduce our organization.
Raoul Education, the parent organization covering a registered educational society, is a reputed quality education provider. It comprises of 52 institutions spread across the Thane and Palghar districts of Maharashtra and Chandauli district of Uttar Pradesh. With the blessings of our honorable chairman, Sir Sri Lalan Tiwari ji, and under the eminent leadership of group secretary, respected Sri Rahul Tiwari ji, and the joint secretary, Madam Srimati Krishna Tiwari and Sri Utsav Tiwari ji, Rahul Education is diligently providing 360-degree quality education in many education streams. Rahul Education's Srimati KL Tiwari College of Architecture, situated in Mira Road, was established in 2016. SKLTCA, along with its team of expert faculties, follows an experiential learning philosophy and has been collaborating with architecture firms, experts and scholars to give an holistic educational learning to its students. So, our talk series, Rubaru, explores the various aspects of architecture subject through critical conscious learning and fact-finding methodology. And I'm pretty sure that it will be a passionate, enthralling ride of historic sessions, getting you all to travel you to our old historic time virtually. So without any further wait, let's get to know our today's speaker of the session, which will be introduced by the Kunal.
So let us begin with the session today on the subject of humanities, Ottoman architecture. Speaker for the day is Architect Nisha Mevada. Architect Nisha Mevada, ma'am, is a Mumbai-based practicing architect and a graduate from Mumbai University. While gaining hands-on experience under esteemed architects Vikas Dilwari and Brinda Somaiya, she began her independent architectural practice. To combine her professional work with teaching and research work, she began her teaching career holding visiting leadership lectureship at various colleges of Mumbai and university. As an independent researcher, she co-curated with Kamil Firat first exhibition in India on Sinan, titled Celebrating Mema Sinan, under the Joint Association of Turkish Consulate General in Mumbai and Rachna Sansar's Academy of Architecture. She is currently pursuing her research on Sinan proportion systems at the University of Texas at Austin. We welcome you, Architect Nisha Ma'am, and request you to begin the second series of Rahul Education Group SKLTCOA talk series Rubaru. Welcome, ma'am.
Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you very much for that elaborate introduction. Good morning and welcome one and all on this Saturday morning. I would begin with thanking SKL Tiwari College of Architecture for giving me this opportunity for being here and to present my ongoing work. More so, I would like to thank Professor Rupali Gupte for giving me this opportunity again. And each time when I come here or whenever I present my work anywhere, I make sure that I'm presenting with an addition that I have brought to this ongoing research work. So a lot of work has been going on, and this is still in its progressive form. So a large part of it you will be able to see in the second part of presentation. Today's presentation is in two parts. The first part is a bit longer, as I know you all are fresh in the morning with all your breakfast, Saturday morning breakfast, and I believe you all can sit a bit longer. So I hope I should be able to do that in about 50 minutes. And then we'll take a short break and look at the second leg of this presentation, which is purely focused on sacred geometry. Sacred geometry and the proportion system, which is large part of my ongoing research. I hope this lecture will open up new ways of looking at architectural history and at historical monuments that you have been looking at so far. And I wish you all are able to travel to these places and even more across the world. All right. Before I begin, I would like to make give a note that is about the photographs that you will be looking at in this presentation. Most of them are by Kamil Ferhat. Kamil Ferhat is a Turkish photographer, a celebrated Turkish photographer, and a lot of these works were put up in UNESCO World Heritage Committee's 40th meeting in Istanbul in 2016. So these are a treasury that you'll be looking at. And a lot of these drawings are coming from MIT and Aga Khan Trust for Architecture. They have put up a lot of these drawings on ArchNet, and I have considerably modified wherever I wanted to for presentational purposes. So yes, and some content is from my already curated exhibition. So that was about the content. And okay, without further ado, I think let's begin with the presentation now. All right, I believe it is just perfectly fine and visible.
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Great. So, okay, so before I keep talking about Sinan's works and who Sinan is, I think it would be best to situate everyone in 16th century, on world maps. So just to give you the bearings of historic, cultural, and geographic situation in 16th century Ottoman Empire. So the Ottomans laid their foundation from a small principality into an empire which ruled over 600 years. It was transformed into a political giant that you see here in this map. The entire green colored portion is the large Ottoman Empire, and this is the Mediterranean Sea. So you can see that almost I think it's more than two-thirds of it is surrounded by the Ottoman Empire. Of course, it transformed into a political giant with cultural power, which started in Asia Minor, that is, it started in Turkey, modern-day Turkey, and subsequently embraced the Mediterranean basin from parts of northern Africa, from Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, Egypt, and all the way till Algeria, that is a lot of these North African countries. Up above there, it goes all the way in a large part of European countries, that is all the way till Austria, Hungary, and Romania, and Ukraine. And so it's a large land parcel. And this was in 16th century, when Ottoman Empire was at its height. And probably this was also called as the Ottoman Golden Age. I would also like to mention, before I go further, I would like to show, because I know that y'all have had a background about Byzantine architecture so far. I think, yes, by Professor Rupali Gupte. So I would like to show you, just to situate y'all on a lighter note, I would want to show you a video here. You were not able to hear the sound, right?
Yeah, your screen isn't shared yet.
Oh, is it? Okay.
Istanbul was Constantinople, now it's Istanbul, not Constantinople. Been a long time gone, oh Constantinople, still is Turkish delight on a moonlit night. Every gal in Constantinople lives in Istanbul, not Constantinople. So if you've a date in Constantinople, she'll be waiting in Istanbul. Even old New York was once New Amsterdam. Why they changed it, I can't say. People just like it better that way. Take me back to Constantinople. No, you can't go back to Constantinople. Now it's Istanbul, not Constantinople. Why did Constantinople get the works? That's nobody's business but the Turks.
Right. I hope that was audible and y'all enjoyed that nice song.
Yes, sir, it was amazing.
So just to situate yourself, that is our situation here in 16th century. So just to situate everyone, we are here and this is what is happening, where a lot of money is flowing in, the empire is spread far and wide. And we see that it was a major crossroad between Europe and Asia, having key trade routes. This significant city was called Byzantium in antiquity, led by the Greeks. Captured and renamed by the Romans as Constantinople, that flourished for about a millennia. The Ottomans had real hard time to capture this city, and finally they did, and turned the Roman Constantinople to Istanbul. And there goes the song. Because of this powerful location and European conquest by the Ottomans, a lot of money was flowing in. So this was the time, the 16th century is considered, the golden age of the Ottoman Empire. This was the time when there was this dire need of creating the face of the empire. And how do you do that? I mean, it goes without saying that on building large infrastructures or infrastructures that are worth the memory of every passerby, worth engraving in the history, for generations to come. That only happens through art and architectural works, right? So this was the time when this dire ambitiousness, led to great architectural works. And I believe Sinan is just right there at the right time, around the right people who valued great art and architecture. In the vast architectural history, the credit of fully realizing the architectural character of domed construction is credited to a single man, Koca Sinan. He was born in Anatolia, that is a Turkish province, a very large area. It was not a small city or a village. It's a large area. It's called Anatolia. He was born in Anatolia in 1490. He was employed in royal military at the age of 22. With his great wit, he served the military at the highest rank till the age of 45. His excellence was rewarded by Sultan Suleiman, by honoring Sinan as Mimar Sinan, Mimar meaning the chief Ottoman architect of that entire vast Ottoman Empire that you have seen in the previous slide. So as a military man, he had traveled far and wide and gained huge experience, with all that he saw around the world. He completed more than 400 projects in his entire long career, from the age of 45 till the age of 95. You heard me correct, from the age of 45 till the age of 95. You know, this is the time when people, at least now that we hear, you know, that people think that, okay, probably I'm nearing my retirement. And, you know, I'm in my second phase of life where I should just start winding up things and giving away things and whatnot. And this man is getting posted to the best phase of his life at the age of 45. From the age of 45 till the age of 95, he completes more than 400 projects. And these 400 projects in his long career of 50 years, there's a huge portfolio, huge body of works in his portfolio, and they are 84 large mosques, 52 small mosques, 57 religious schools, 7 Quranic schools, 22 mausoleums or tombs, 20 caravanserais, 52 public baths. He does 34 palaces, out of which also includes some restoration works. He does 8 bridges. He does 3 hospitals. He does some granaries, fountains, aqueducts, which I have not listed here. But I mean, this is an incredible achievement in 16th century, where, you know, resources are limited. And so just to give you a comparison with modern day architects, let's look at Charles Goria. Looked up, much celebrated Indian architect who completed about 500 projects in his career. And these include built and unbuilt works of Charles Goria. Another great figure, again, from the modern times is Frank Lloyd Wright. And he completed accurately 532 projects in his lifetime. So this certainly states what 400 projects meant in 16th century, when there are limited availability of resources and technology. Sinan's contemporaries had not documented his work in volumes or preserved his drawings, as we find them extensively in Western architectural history. We have poetry that glorified his art and architecture, but no real description of Sinan himself, his philosophies, his ideologies, how he worked in, you know, with architectural projects, his experiences. But there is one absolutely valuable resource that we have till today, and that is Sinan's autobiography, which is Teskiresul Bunyan. This was written when Sinan was more than 90 years of age. This was partially written by Sinan in first person. And then there is a part written by his friend where Sinan is narrating, his friend Tai Mustafa Çelebi. And this is written in Ottoman Turkish language. This book manuscript, I should say, is in Topkapı Palace Museum in Istanbul, and it has been translated in several languages. This gives a very detailed account of his personal experiences with architecture. Of course, nothing about his personal life is written in here, but it's a very resourceful book to at least look at, wherein he mentions about only 6 of his projects, and Sai mentions about he completing more than 400 projects. In fact, on Sinan's tomb, there is a calligraphy written by Sai Mustafa Çelebi, and even there he mentions that he completed more than 400 projects. So that is where we get this number 400. Of course, not all 400 survive today. There are somewhere about 150 or so that are surviving today. But we don't have that exhaustive list of 400 projects. In this manual, he himself very meticulously divides his entire career in four parts. But before that, I would like to mention that a large part, he served three Ottoman sultans, and out of which he largely served Sultan Suleiman for greater number of years, because he was the longest reigning sultan by then, and very passionate about art and architecture, and I think he was a wonderful patron. This is why I mentioned that Sinan was at the right time, at the right age, when there's a lot of money flowing in, when he has the right patron to motivate him and to allow him to do to allow him to experiment with all his architectural and engineering skills. So in this manual, Tezkiretul Bunyan, Sinan very meticulously, as an introspection of his own work, he classifies his 50 long year career into three stages. And he says that he has had 20 years of apprenticeship period. Then he had had 20 years of his qualification period. And the remaining years of his life were spent in his mastery stage. So here in this presentation, I have picked one monument, and all these are mosque complexes. These are sultanic mosque complexes, because they were sultanic, meaning commissioned by the royal family, commissioned by the sultan. Definitely there is huge amount of money, huge amount of ambition that goes in the background. And with that said, there is tremendous pressure on an architect to be just to the sultan's ambition, produce that quality of work that is expected. So we are going to look at these three sultanic complexes from all his career stages in his career. So let's begin with Shahzade complex. That is from his apprenticeship period. Then we will look at Suleymaniye complex, and towards the end, we will look at Selimiye complex. So yeah, here it is. And I know that you all are aware of Hagia Sophia and how it was constructed, and a little story, a background about it. So in this Google map, I'm showing you this roughly triangular area. This is Istanbul Historic Peninsula, and this comprises of seven hills, just like Rome was, and that's how when the Roman Empire shifted their capital here and converted this Byzantium city to Constantinople, they were very happy that even this city has seven hills. So just like Rome, Istanbul also has seven hills, and all seven hills number one has Hagia Sophia, and rest all six has Sinan monuments. So the skyline of historic Istanbul has Sinan's monuments dotting its peak, various peaks, I would say. So I marked Hagia Sophia just to show you the proximity of this monument. Because there will be few details that we are going to touch upon. All right, so this is Marmara Sea. This is the Bosphorus Strait that meets the Black Sea. This is the Golden Horn. And yes, so let's look at the Shahzade complex plan. It was the Shahzade Mosque complex was commissioned by Sultan Suleiman when Sinan was a newly appointed Mimar Sinan, the chief Ottoman architect. This was commissioned in the memory of Suleiman's son, that is Shahzade, the prince, who died out of various reasons. It's very controversial how he died, but some historians believe that he died out of some disease. Some believe he was murdered. So this mosque was commissioned by Suleiman in the memory of his son. And you will notice that the mosque is sitting in the center of the complex, and there are few important buildings around. Say number two is a madrasa, that is a religious school, and then there are guest rooms. There is a caravanserai with a stable, horse stable parking area, and there is a soup kitchen. And again, there is an elementary school. So this kind of a facility complex was very common at this time in 16th century, because there was this rising urban demand. And who else can commission such a large facility complex other than the Sultan, who has all the money, right? So it was not just the mosque, but it was a religious complex. So we will only focus on the mosque design, because that is where we see great achievements of or great skills of Sinan's works. All right. So this is the plan, and all the three mosque complexes, or rather the mosque that we are going to see, I'm going to talk. You will largely find these two components in the plans of all these three mosques, and that is the one component is the fountain court, this one, and the prayer hall, this one. So, one can enter from any side. It doesn't really matter from where you are entering into a mosque. Of course, it is customary to have the wazoo done. That is, you need to wash your hands and feet, and then enter the mosque, and then offer the prayer, offer the sajda, and, be there in the prayer hall. It is very likely that, particularly on Fridays, when they have the Juma prayer, the Friday prayer, it is very likely that the prayer hall is not sufficient, and we need a spillover kind of an area. So this fountain court is like a spillover area where people accommodate there and they offer their prayers. So fountain court is, of course, like a transitional, a very nice welcoming courtyard, semi-covered courtyard kind of an area, but it also serves like a spillover area when it is heavily crowded on special days. So we will be looking at the prayer hall, and we'll be looking at all the four sides of the prayer hall. We are not going to focus on this. We will look at the details of this wall, which is called the Qibla wall. A Qibla wall is the wall that gives you a sense of orientation towards the Mecca. And this is where all the Muslims are expected to orient themselves for offering prayers, for offering sajda. So this is the wall that is something that is, the devotee would always look at. And it goes without saying that if that is something that one looks for in a large prayer hall, that means that has to be designed with utmost care, right? So here is a photograph of taken from this angle. And you see the backside of the Qibla wall, the backside of the Qibla wall. I want to focus, before I go there, I want to just quickly run through the plan. And the plan looks like this. So there is a large central dome, which is supported on four columns and a square baldachin, as you see here, a square baldachin. A baldachin is a space underneath the, or rather the frame underneath the dome. It's not the space. The space could be, could may or may not be as per the baldachin. So here the baldachin is square, and that square baldachin is supported on four semi-domes. Okay, so two domes on this axis, two semi-domes on this axis, one here, one here. These semi-domes also have two more mini semi-domes, I would say, in all the bays. So all you see here is there is a systematic hierarchy of placing the domes, because one is supporting the another is supporting the another, the following one, right? So this is a very clear indication of a very meticulously worked out bearing system. You know, just like the frame structures that we have today, if I have to give you an example of RCC framed buildings, the load is transferred from RCC floor slab to RCC beam, from beam to column to footing, right? So similarly, this hierarchy, hierarchy in the bearing system is seen in Sinan's works. And this is the reason why he could make optimum use of materials, and we will see that. I mean, I will make that very clear till the end of this presentation, what is meant by optimum use of materials. So let us look at the Qibla wall here. As you see, there is this intentional thinner wall, a thicker wall, a thinner wall, a thicker wall, then again thin, thick, thin, thick, thin, thick, and that continues. And what is happening is all these buttresses, or rather these thicker walls, are pushed outside. And on the interior side, they are kept as flat as possible, because that is the first thing that a visitor want to see and is going to face to offer the prayers. So would you like to see these undulations in the wall of, you know, projecting, receding on that interior facade where you are actually seeing and offering prayers? Would you like to see that, or would you like to have a clean facade, right? I'm sure everybody will opt for a clean facade. So being very sensitive on the visual experience of the viewer, Sinan has very meticulously worked that out here. Then I would like to focus your attention on these two. I have now rotated the plan. This is the Qibla wall here. This is the Qibla wall here. And these two are the side gallery walls. They are identical. So we'll just look at this lower one right now. And here is the photograph. But before looking at the photograph, try to understand what's happening in the plan. Again, there is this thinner, thicker walls. And what are they doing? The thicker walls are actually the buttresses that is supporting this pier. And that pier is here. So this buttress is here, and it is like a flying buttress to the pier. And that flying buttress is actually embedded into the structure. It is not jutting out, and it is not speaking aloud that I am a flying buttress to this structure. So there is a buttress. I'll not use the word flying buttress. There is a buttress which is very carefully, very neatly embedded into the structure. And you see, even this is the buttress. This is the buttress, which is, you know, which is cut wherever the material is not required. So in that reference, I'll just make a very quick sketch, because I know people generally have a bit difficulty in understanding this. So imagine this is the pillar here, this one up here, and you have a buttress out there. Okay, an arch form, a buttress. And then to support this, you need another buttress. This is in section. All right. So as you see that how meticulously he has worked out this smooth transition of the structural material. And to do that, to disguise that buttress, he has added this galleries, as you see here, the gallery here, and that gallery is added up above as well. So that's the reason why both the side facades are identical. And this is a very effective, very neat disguising of the buttress. I mean, just imagine if you don't have these side galleries, you will see the buttresses jutting out and you would know that this is a structural element and the building would look robust and not very aesthetically pleasing. So yes, this clearly shows the smooth transition of the bearing system from one to another, from main dome to semi-dome, semi-dome, main dome to semi-dome, semi-dome to the side mini domes, and then the structure transitions out till the side gallery area. So, you know, there is this man-made hill kind of an effect to the monument. Okay, we have seen these three walls. I'm going to look at this entrance wall now. And the entrance wall, as I told you, the fountain court is an overspill area for those who are praying. The buttresses are projecting totally into the interiors, the thicker walls, as I told you, the thicker walls, the buttresses are projecting totally into the interiors. One trespasses them without even realizing their presence. When you enter, you actually pass through them, but you do not notice because all your eyes, all your gaze is at this wall. As a devotee, of course, as a devout, you would want to find a spot there and start offering your prayer. So you would definitely not know that you actually pass through the buttresses, and that to those thick buttresses. So it is the least conspicuous space where one can expect the structural members to be. So again, this is a very, very effective way of housing the structural elements, but they do not come in the visual experience of the viewer. So here is one image, but I think, yeah, this is the entrance. This is this entire thing is an entrance wall. This image will show you better that how deep these buttresses are. They are very deep, and when you enter, you do not even notice that you actually crossed through that heavy buttress. All right, some images. This is looking towards the Qibla wall, and you see how the Qibla wall, you don't see those heavy jutting out buttresses, the in, out of the wall, which is actually happening on the exterior, but not in the interior. The Qibla wall is looking as neat as possible. And because of having those thinner walls, he knows that, of course, thinner walls are now non-load bearing walls because the structure is now is very effectively worked out, right? It is no more an entire load bearing wall. Some walls are non-load bearing, and all those non-load bearing walls are heavily fenestrated. And this is why he could incorporate a lot of natural light in these monuments, which is so rare in 16th century, or rather any historic monument. You just go and see that how dark and how deprived of natural light they are, especially very large, voluminous, very spacious, monuments. So Working out this bearing system was very, very effective to incorporate natural light. And some more photographs, a reflected ceiling view where all the geometry is very clearly visible. The central dome supported on four semi-domes, and the four semi-domes also had those little mini semi-domes that are supporting the semi-domes, and a very swift form that is coming down from circle to a square in the plan. Okay, so here to emphasize on Sinan's structural and spatial purity, I bring you a comparative set of Professor Doğan Kuban from Istanbul Technical University. Two buildings from the west have been compared with Şehzade, these two buildings from the west with Şehzade. One from the 16th century Renaissance period and the other from 7th century Roman period are being compared with the Şehzade Mosque. All three buildings have same design theory of having the central dome supported on four semi-domes, but all are executed in different ways. In case of these two Western buildings, the volumetric quality of the space does not correspond to the spatial quality of the space, which means if you, because these domes are elevated on these drums, the volume is extensively high compared to the spatial axis of the building, compared to the spatial quality of the building. Even this one, the spatial quality to the voluminous quality, it does not correspond at all. I mean, one would have a different experience when the moment one is entering this gallery space, and then one is entering and standing probably here is a very different experience. And until one reaches the center, one would feel as if one is standing under in the vault. But that does not happen in Sinan's buildings because the spatial and the volumetric quality of the space correspond to each other in relation with the human proportion. The voluminous quality is not so high that it crushes the human proportion. You know, it shouldn't be that adulterated in ambition that I'm going to build the highest or I'm going to build the tallest, and then you just goof up everything because the building is probably made for superhumans. It should correspond to our proportion, right? So this was the quality of Sinan's architecture. Just to bring to your notice, he has placed this building in his apprenticeship period. I mean, this is a remarkable achievement, but he has placed this in apprenticeship period. So let's look what's coming from his qualification period. And I'm going to switch to now Süleymaniye complex, which is again very close to Şehzade complex. I mean, one can actually walk up. It is slightly an uphill way, but it is definitely walkable and worth the walk because you see a lot of traditional Ottoman houses, Ottoman architecture, wooden houses. All right. So again, that shows you the proximity with Hagia Sophia, with Şehzade, and this is placed on the third hill of Istanbul Historic Peninsula, overlooking the water body. The site was spectacularly chosen. As the name goes, Süleymaniye, that means it is built for Sultan Süleyman himself. It must definitely equate his might and his presence on the world map. So this monument actually should project Süleyman as what he is. This is a great challenge for an architect to present his patron with the face of architecture. So it's a very large complex, such large urban facility complexes, as I told you, were common in these times, and only the sultans could offer such complexes. a large complex where the center is dominated with the mosque, and surrounding it there are these madrasas, madrasas that is a religious school, and then there are these hospitals of hospitals for mentally challenged people, a regular hospital, a caravanserai, a guest house, and whatnot, all kinds of a huge urban facility complex, if I have to put it in a nutshell. And then behind, there is a graveyard garden where Sultan Suleiman's grave is found here, right in the axis, in central axis here, and then his favorite wide tomb and things like and such other tombs. We will focus again only on the mosque, and just to show you that it dominates, the third hill overlooks the Golden Horn, the Bosphorus, and it's a spectacular sight. Okay, so here's the plan. Okay, the plan has a similar configuration of two components, that is a fountain court here and the prayer hall there. The prayer hall is roughly squarish with a central dome supported on two semi-domes, and the other two identical sides are supported by the two sets of thicker or deeper buttresses. We will now look at, I've rotated the plan, and again, showing you in a similar pattern. We will be looking at the Qibla wall again, and this photograph is taken from this angle. So you see the Qibla wall here, the Qibla wall where all the buttresses are jutting out, and the interior side of the Qibla wall is as flat as possible, as you see. Again, same scheme is employed. But here, the difference is, and a very beautiful, a very effective way of smoothening these giant buttresses, because the span of the dome and the monumentality of this building is, or rather this structure, is quite higher than what we saw at Shehzadeh. The dome span at Shehzadeh is 22 meters, or I think 21 meters, and Suleymaniye is 27.5 meters. So of course it calls for a very larger area, larger amount of masonry that goes into it. So definitely larger structural sections, right? Larger sizes of these structural members. So these buttresses are large, but just imagine, had these been abruptly going up, and you would be having these 90 degree cornice out here, not this smooth cornice. So just to elaborate that further, I'm zooming in one of these cornices that is here, and you see he has very effectively incorporated, or rather smoothened, this edge of the building, because I mean, had he not done this, it would have looked really robust. So adding these stalactite members, or rather it is called as mukarnas in Ottoman architecture, or rather in Islamic architecture, I should say. So incorporating this, the edges become very smooth, and this is something that we do not find in classical architecture nowhere. This is I think first time done, attempted by someone, thought about the form so intentionally and so meticulously worked out. We'll be looking at the side galleries again, and it goes without saying, all that I explained earlier in Shehzadeh Mosque, again, the same thing is happening. There are these thicker walls, or rather these buttresses, and these buttresses have these other sets of thinner, thicker walls, and it has these galleries. But here, the side galleries look even more slender and lace-like, making the monumental facade very light. You know, just to have a quick comparison with the gallery at Shahzadeh, this shows, I mean, when we look at this, and then when we look at this, this clearly shows that Sinan's exceeding taste in furthering his structural and aesthetical skills. A single element, that is this arch, and just try to see that how this arch is used in varying proportions in progressing and receding arithmetic progression. So here you see a different proportion, here you see a different lace-like proportion up above, and this height is what you get in that one cone of vision when you are standing down there. So, you know, this is very intentionally done, that whatever goes at the eye level, it shouldn't be so monumental that it just hits your face and you are not able to absorb the monumentality, or rather, you know, the effect of that entire mass of the building. I mean, as humans, as I told you, these buildings has to be designed for humans and not for superhumans. So we have a capacity of viewing and absorbing things, right? So as I said, the cone of vision, when you're standing here, till this roof level is all that you can absorb in one cone of vision. And the moment you go behind, you see the entire scheme, and you start registering that, okay, that one arch is now getting bigger. And then it very, very beautifully and aesthetically, it fits in that entire facade, and it harmoniously speaks one language. At the same time, it doesn't intimidate or doesn't crush the human proportion. So this is very, very essential, very sensitive of Sinan to play with that one component of arch spread across the entire monumental length of the facade. This is the interior photograph of Süleymaniye Mosque. And here we are looking at the Qibla wall that has the mihrab, the niche that is a marker that this is the Qibla wall. And of course, it has the surah written around it in Arabic calligraphy, just to accentuate its presence on the Qibla wall. But what I want you all to see in this image particularly are these two massive piers that have these niches. And here is the photograph. So this interior view is looking at the Qibla wall, the dome and the semi-dome, and the large arches on either side with lots of windows on the tympana. And the niche is an intentional scooping out of the wall to reduce the mass at the eye level. This niche is not going all the way up there. It is only up there because, as I told you, we have a certain specific cone of vision that we get in that one site. So in within that one site, he has, he has understood those dynamics, those proportions of a human, and how that cone of vision sets in from what distance and all. And within that distance only, or within that height only, he has scooped out this extra mass of the wall. So that makes the pier look lighter. Okay, some good photographs, a reflected ceiling view, another view that shows that there is a flood of natural light due to those thinner non-load-bearing walls, due to that large tympana. And here, I would like you to notice that there are these chandeliers, and these chandeliers were oil-burning lamps in those days. So there were more than 300 oil-burning lamps. And these lamps would generate huge amount of soot, that and the soot has a tendency to get collected on the wall and it would get really dirty, and one would have to go on cleaning that all over, or rather would have to do meticulous periodic cleaning and things like that. So, you know, that has had to be accounted. Sinan devised a very effective way to channelize that suit into a room, and that is here at the entrance. So this is the fountain court. One enters, and one is in the prayer hall. But here in the entrance, the thicker buttress, he could house an entire room there. Up there, I'm going to zoom in that part here. This part is being zoomed in here. This is the entrance. Above the entrance, there is a suit chamber. So he understood that the wind currents would pass in a certain way, and this is where the suit would get collected. And of course, there are holes dug in this slab, and I could get a chance to see this when I visited in 2018. And these are some of the views. So there are these holes dug under this slab, four holes dug. So the suit actually travels, and of course, since the suit is so light, it has the tendency of traveling further up and up. So of course, it travels through these four holes, and it gets collected into this chamber. The best part is, whatever suit was collected here, so all this black is we still have that suit here since so many years, and this suit would not go waste. He devised a wonderful system wherein this suit would be used to make ink for the calligraphers, and that is amazing because that ink was used by special calligraphic calligraphers. Say who are doing calligraphy for the Quran or such other important royal books. So nothing is going waste. Even he's making use of every waste particle, I should say. So this is from the fountain court. You see these four windows, 1, 2, 3, 4, here, that is the suit chamber above the entrance. There are many, remarkable design features, but we do not have time for all that. And I'm going to show you two more, that's it. So one is about these chandeliers. These chandeliers, were very large. And these chandeliers had these ostrich eggs planted in between the design. And these eggs would secrete a chemical from the atmosphere such that it would repel the spiders and mosquitoes away. So just another view of chandelier, and you can see the ostrich eggs. And these were the oil burning lamps. Now they run on electricity. So the last feature that I would like to talk about is that, of course, when it is such a large space, and as you can see, probably this was taken by Kamil Farhat on a Friday, when you see the entire prayer hall is filled with people and they are all offering sajda, and I think it was intentionally clicked to get this beautiful picture. But this gives you a sense that so many people inside a circular domed ceiling, and we all know that a domed form is more susceptible to echoes. So, it's the responsibility of an architect to cater to that because it's a large space, a huge amount of people coming in. And of course, there is the muezzin, that is a religious scholar. He's speaking out loud. He is calling prayer from this platform called Dikka. He's calling prayer from there, and everybody performing. So his voice is definitely going to be echoed. Sinan devised a wonderful scheme. He used acoustic resonators which is a special cut stone planted in the main dome and the two semi-domes. 64 such stone blocks were installed. Cavity resonators placed in a dome prevent the reflection of the sound energy and re-radiate it throughout the room. By re-radiating the incident energy in all the directions, the room becomes a diffused sound field, and thus the danger of echo due to delayed reflection from the dome is eliminated completely. So these were the cut stone blocks that were placed here, you know, one wall. Of course, in the tension zone of the dome, not in the compression zone. Otherwise, this hollow would definitely crack. So this would be somewhere right above the windows. All right, so here it is. And okay, I will respect the time more here, and I will skip this comparison because I think that is not really important. I will now quickly take Selimiye mask. That is the last mask that comes from his mastery period. And this is not in Istanbul. We have been looking at Istanbul so far, but we'll be going out of Istanbul somewhere 250 kilometers far in a city called Edirne. And Istanbul, this triangular peninsula, I'm zooming out. And that little triangular peninsula is here. And we are going to travel towards Europe, 250 kilometers to a city called Edirne. I'm zooming into Edirne. And this is a small, humble city of Edirne. And this is, this is Selimiye Mosque. You see all major roads are go towards Selimiye Mosque, or rather I would say again it was a very very keen decision to situate the mosque in a spectacular location where the mosque is visible from all sides of the city. So this was strategically located because all European travelers who would want to go to Istanbul would actually take any of these roads, and they would definitely pass by Selimiye, and Selimiye would be their encounter of, as I told you, architecture represents the face of the empire. So Selimiye would represent Ottoman might. So this was also a tremendous pressure because a sultanic mosque and something that is the face of the empire. So it was a challenging brief, definitely, for Sinan. This mosque is for Sultan Selim, who succeeded his father, Sultan Suleiman, after his death. So that is why it is called Selimiye Mosque. The mosque is not a very big complex due to several reasons, but it is a fairly large site that has two madrasas, two religious schools. The mosque sits in the center, and there is a huge market which is functioning till today, and this acts like a retaining wall to this entire hill. It's not very hilly, this market and acts like a retaining wall. This number 5 is market. We'll focus on the mosque itself. And here, this is going to be a bit difficult. So please try to focus even more. Because the structural bearing system is completely different from all that we have been seeing. The structural bearing system here, the dome, there is a central dome, and this dome is equal to that of Hagia Sophia. Not that Sinan could not build something higher than something larger than Hagia Sophia, but that was not the intention. He was dealing with sacred geometry and proportions. These numbers that Hagia Sophia is 31.5 and I can build 33 or I can build 34 meter wide dome. That was not the intention for him. he was purely being biased to these sacred geometry, sacred mathematical figures that, you know, that led him to these designs, which is the second part of the presentation. So I will move further with the design. There is a central dome, 31.5 meter dome, is supported on an octagonal baldachin. Okay, as you see, octagonal baldachin. And this octagonal baldachin sits in a roughly squarish plan. Okay, this is the this is the fountain court, needless to say that. But as you see, this looks really different. So the dome, let's do this. As I told you, it is slightly difficult to clearly read Selimiye. So we will divide the facade in four levels or four registries. So the topmost is the circular base of the dome, level number one. Level number two is the octagonal base that is here, this octagonal base. And you see this octagonal base has these semi-domes on the diagonal axis. Okay, so that is why you see these semi-domes here, because they are on the diagonal axis. So that is level number two. Level number three is this squarish base, that is this one. And as you clearly see, there are three large arches with tympanas. Tympanas with a huge amount of fenestration. So each side has three arches, each of these sides, that is three here, and three large here. So in total, nine arches at this level, at level number three. Level number four is the gallery level that we will see, and it is very obvious. Let us look at the plan, and I have rotated the plan just to focus on the Qibla wall. Here, something different is happening. There is a Qibla Iwan added, because this Iwan acts like a buttress to these two piers. And while having that Iwan there, he added these galleries that continue from the side galleries, and with the galleries, of course, he could disguise that these are the buttresses, or rather this is a structural component to the mosque. It also adds adds to the overall cascading effect of the building. And of course it is reasonable enough, because this is the southeast facade. A huge amount of beating up sun on a sunny day, on a rainy day, on a snowy stormy day as well. So not that it is not required, and it is there. It has a reason, a very satisfying reason. All right, and okay, so let us look at the side galleries. These are very different from all that you have been seeing. Because all that you see here is, here the side galleries are added, but then where is the buttress? Is this entirely the buttress? Or is this dark portion only the buttress, and this additional jutting out is, we don't know what is that. This entire assembly is the buttress, and this whole thing is supporting this column. It's a buttress to this column. What is happening here is completely different. We have seen solid side buttresses so far, in Sinan's Suleymaniye and Shahzade mosque. We haven't seen a hollow buttress. What is a hollow buttress doing? This is an amazing discovery that Sinan does. And I would like to relate, most of y'all are in your in your second year right now, but then when you will be in your fourth semester, you will learn that when we push the material away from its neutral axis, the entire structural section is even more effective. Okay, so here he has pushed the material, that is the stone walls, away from its neutral axis. He has housed the staircase inside, and this entire assembly becomes a structural component. So of course, he's not making this a solid stone wall, which he could have done the way he did at Suleimani. But this is a huge dome span calling for a huge amount of thrust. And that means it calls for a huge amount of masonry that is required to buttress this this thrust coming from the column. All right. But all that he does is he devises this amazing scheme of double diaphragm wall and houses the staircase inside. And by doing that, let's see what happens in the exterior facade. And just reminding you of Suleimani's exterior, the side gallery facade. And we know that this is the buttress because they are solid. There is no puncture. There is, we know that they are solid. That means they are not accessible, right? But that is not happening at Suleimani. Because those are double diaphragm walls, materials pushed away from the neutral axis, he could house the staircase, and he could also puncture the wall there. And so you see this continuous, seamless, there is this continuity of the elements going all through the facade. And one doesn't know that this is, oh, this is the structural member, this is the buttress to the to this monumental structure. So this principle is very, very effective to make optimum utilization of material. Okay, now here comes the interiors. And here the external monumentality corresponds to that of its interiors. We can clearly read here the four levels that I've been talking about, or at least the three clear levels, that is these three and three arch levels, that is the nine arches, and then the octagonal dome base level, and then the circular dome base level. So we can clearly read that because there is this geometric purity in Sinan's mosque. And on entering Selinier, one is struck by the sheer grandiosity of the space in its spatial and volumetric quality. The site of massive pier, the large tympana arches, and the dome is apparent without feeling a tension of transition from square to octagon and to circular base. Without the enormous natural light that Selinier offers, it would be hard to appreciate the rhythm of the interior form. The light animates the space to its innate nature, embodying the void, the metaphysics of Islamic faith. At the human eye level, the structure is in its proliferated form, drawing the gaze towards the center of the dome, the void, on the vertical axis of human aspiration. So, which is exactly equivalent to the quality of fana that is being talked about in Islamic tradition. You must have seen the dervishes, the whirling dervishes, dancing on that central axis. So that central vertical axis is given that importance. And here the vertical axis there's no defined vertical axis, but then the axis is that invisibility of the gaze that takes you right from here, you go all up there, and it all stops at that one point in the center of the dome. And that is the unity, or the principle or the element of fana that they are, or the tawhid as they are talking, that is unity with God, unity with Allah, that they are talking about in Islamic faith. So I think this is a tremendously a monumental, or rather a very difficult task for an architect, to bring the metaphysics of faith into the built form, to make the visitor experience the essence of the faith through these blocks of stone. So it definitely requires intelligence, and much beyond that requires huge amount of knowledge that we will be talking about in the second leg of this presentation. Just a couple of views, quickly running through them because they are spectacular. Yeah, this beautiful reflected ceiling shows the details of the stylized attenuation of the walls at the entrance level. Okay, there's this last detail that I will talk about for this monument, and that is the minarets, because the minarets are extremely tall, and they have a reason. And this is a distinguished feature of this monument. These minarets are about 83 meters high, taller than any other minaret in the Ottoman realm. This is also the tallest minaret in the world from the classical time. But that is not really important. Important is about its structural uniqueness. Their soaring verticality provides a marked contrast to the massive and imposing domical structure of the prayer hall, and provides a spatial frame that both draws attention to the mosque and Edirne skyline, and thus sets it apart. The remarkable feat of engineering is that two of these minarets, that is these two, which are facing, overlooking the fountain court, both these minarets have triple staircases inside, and all these triple staircases they land on all these three balconies. So here is a drawing, and you could see that there are triple staircases all landing on all three balconies. And again, this there is this symbolism of fana or tawhid again attached here, and the symbolism attached is that different human aspirations. We all are different, all right? So the three different staircases, we all are different, we all have aspirations, but ultimately all our aspirations lead to that vertical axis of always soaring higher and achieving something that is ultimate and that is the best, and that marks the end and completeness of everything, right? So I think it's a tremendous feat of engineering, going 83 meters tall in this time where there is no mention of high-rise building, no technology of high-rise building, but this is being done. So I want to just quickly draw this shows the triple staircase, because I got the opportunity to go to the top balcony on one of the minarets. And this is my photograph where I had to take that staircase, jump over here, and then come onto the landing of the minaret, because these two staircases were not functional after the second balcony. So it was amazing. Anyway, just to draw a quick comparison of Selimiye with Gol Gumbaz, since we are very much familiar with this monument, since it is in India. But Gol Gumbaz is about roughly 43-44 meter span dome, and I've scaled both these plans to its actual scales, or rather to its proportional scales. This is 31.5 meter span dome, but look at the amount of masonry that goes around Gol Gumbaz, and look at the amount of masonry that goes in Sinan's monument. So that is effective optimum utilization that Sinan does. And Gol Gumbaz was constructed 50 years after Selimiye. All that we see is the structural refinement of Gol Gumbaz is actually in its infant stage, and so non-engineered. They are simply thick walls, and thick walls of 3 meters, minimum 3 meters thickness, that is as wide as the room that probably you are sitting inside, 10 feet wide room. It's as thick as that. That is crazy. It is non-engineered. And of course, if you have such thick walls, you don't need buttresses. That's what I mean. It's the wall itself is enough. So non-engineered, non-optimal use of material. So I think this clearly highlights what Sinan was doing and why this effective, detailed working out of each side of the mosque walls was important, just to utilize the material to its optimum possibility, minimize the material from the top till the bottom, but does not compromise on its structural stability. It's been more than 400 years and still these buildings are standing. So that brings me to a very quick run through on what was happening in 16th century. The idea of heavenly dome was prevailing since the time of Roman bathhouses, the dome ceilings in the Roman palaces that ultimately achieved its civic pride with the construction of Pantheon. They were primarily backed with bigger is better philosophy, which very much prevails still today in the reading of their historic monuments. When the West built monuments like Florence Cathedral and St. Peter's Cathedral, the stories were and are about the scale of these monuments and the span of their big domes. It was not about its architectural supremacy in spatial quality, the structural superiority, or the quality of the interior light, the inside-out relationship of the building and things like that. Geometric purity was never in the intellectual foreground. This is why they comfortably use double domes. That is, we see in Florence Cathedral, we see in St. Peter's Cathedral, they have used double domes. So, as Sinan comes from the Renaissance period, I will quickly draw your attention to the famous works that were happening at this time. And just quickly marking some reference point that Florence Cathedral, having a largest brick dome in the classical world, it had 42 meters dome, and it took about 166 years to complete this building, Florence Cathedral. And St. Peter's Basilica, that again has a very wide dome, I think somewhere about 40 meters dome. This building took 160 years to complete, and then later, I'm talking about this building, U.S. Capitol at Washington, D.C., which was built in Industrial Revolution, that is 1868, as mentioned here. The architect of this building was building the dome in cast iron, but he looked back at the Ottoman domes and specifically Sinan's domes. This building also took 40 years in industrial revolution era, whereas Sinan's Süleymaniye complex, not just the mosque, mark my words, Süleymaniye complex, and we know there are a host of buildings in Süleymaniye complex, this entire complex was built in just 7 years. Selimiye complex took only 6 years. So this goes without saying that, how efficient Sinan was, and, with his military experience, he could work out, the project in such a way, in a timely manner, that it had to finish in that particular time. At the same time, there were huge resources in the Ottoman, in this age, in this time of the Ottoman Empire. So that clearly shows Sinan's skillful abilities, but he's so undermentioned in history. Another thing that I would like to mention is these minarets of Selimiye are 83 meters tall, which is equivalent to 27-story high building. Imagine a 27-story in 16th century. No one had thought of this ever about. So Istanbul, or rather, you know, Turkey falls under this earthquake fault line. So, of course, he built these 83-meter tall minarets as having earthquake-resistant engineering, or rather seismic-resistant engineering skills he had developed. And that is why they are still standing. They never failed in these past, 400, 450 years. So this is a great feat of engineering, and it is so under-mentioned. I mean, Sinan's masteries are so under-mentioned. This is the last slide for this part of the presentation, and that is, I'm bringing you a slider from National Geographic's website, wherein they are comparing the domes the domed buildings in the 16th, 17th centuries across the world. And you can see here that, there are two monuments from India, Taj Mahal and Gol Gumbaz, and all these monuments, we know Pantheon, we know Hagia Sophia is here, St. Peter's Basilica, Florence Cathedral, U.S. Capitol, Wisconsin, all these are there, U.S. Capitol at Washington, D.C., all these are there. But there is no mention of Sinan's monument. It is so sad that how history is represented. These monuments are not that structurally refined, structurally engineered. They do not represent several qualities that Sinan's buildings had, the uniqueness that Sinan's buildings had. And another thing that, we refer in history of architecture, we refer to Bannister Fletcher's History of Architecture book. And that book, sadly, has no mention of Sinan's works, or rather even Sinan, this word also does not exist in the entire book. It's nowhere there in the index. I went through several times and I was shocked and amazed at what's happening. So of course this has a very political propaganda of suppressing certain things, which I will not go over right now, but just to bring to your notice that how history of architecture is deceived, and we are always glorifying the West, missing out several good things that exist. And so here I will give you a break of, say, about, we can take a break of about 2 to 3 minutes, if that is okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, and then we will come back. We'll come back for something fun.
Okay, ma'am.
Hello, I hope you all are there. And
yes, ma'am.
Great, so we will begin now. And so the thing that we are going to see now is we are going to talk about sacred geometry or sacred geometric proportions. But before I begin, I want to, I think Donald Duck will introduce you all to certain mathematical principles, and he is going to talk about, or rather even he's discovering that in this video, about golden proportions. Just go over it, just see what is golden proportion. There are many other proportion systems, but for now, just get introduced to golden proportion. So here it goes. Okay. Please let me know if the sound is not audible when I'm playing the video.
Okay, ma'am. Yes, ma'am, the sound is audible.
Well, I'll be a password egghead.
It was our old friend Pythagoras who discovered that the pentagram was full of mathemagic. The two shorter lines combined exactly equal the third. And this line shows the magic proportions of the famous golden section. The second and third lines exactly equal the fourth. Once again, we have the golden section. But this is only the beginning. Hidden within the pentagram is a secret for creating a golden rectangle, which the Greeks admired for its beautiful proportions and magic qualities. The star contains the golden rectangle many times over. It's a most remarkable shape. It can mathematically reproduce itself indefinitely. All these rectangles have exactly the same proportions. This figure also contains a magic spiral that repeats the proportions of the golden section into infinity. To the Greeks, the golden rectangle represented a mathematical law of beauty. We find it in their classical architecture. The Parthenon, perhaps one of the most famous of early Greek buildings, contains many golden rectangles. Proportions are also found in their sculpture. centuries that followed, the golden rectangle dominated the idea of beauty in architecture throughout the Western world. The Cathedral of Notre Dame is an outstanding example. The Renaissance painters knew this secret well. Today, the golden rectangle is very much a part of our modern world. Modern painters have rediscovered the magic of these proportions. Indeed, this ideal proportion is to be found in life itself.
Boy, oh boy, oh boy. This is mathematics. I got mathematical figures like that.
Donald.
Get me to it.
No, no.
Ideal proportion.
Not quite. No, I'm afraid not. Well, we can't all be mathematically perfect.
Oh, yeah? Yeah, I knew I could do it.
Now that you're all pent up in a pentagon, let's see how nature uses this same mathematical form, the petunia, the star jasmine, the starfish, the wax flower, there are literally thousands of members in good standing in nature's Pythagorean society of the star. All nature's works have a mathematical logic, and her patterns are limitless. The magic proportions of the golden section are often found in the spirals of nature's designs. The profusion of mathematical forms brings to mind the words of Pythagoras.
That was enough. I will get back to my screen. All right, I understand that several of you might be having questions and might be wondering about a lot of things. Please write your questions in the chat. I'll be very happy to take them towards the end. Right now, I'll try to move through this as quick as possible. As that video mentioned about the Greeks discovering these golden proportions, but it is not only the golden proportions, or rather, I would say, yes, they began with golden proportions, and that is Plato, Socrates, then Pythagoras, you know, so there were these thinkers and mathematicians and astronomers, and all these fields of study were getting combined, inspired with each other, and trying to add to that knowledge that, you know, the previous person had just come up with an idea. And this started to get reflected in architecture later in the Roman times, because the Roman Empire came after, or rather followed after Greece. So they did follow these proportions, but not much, towards the 3rd and 4th century BC, 4th century ADs. And later on, this knowledge started diminishing to such an extent that it was only there in the books. It was
barely practiced in architecture. In arts, it was, but then not to that extent. Yes. So there was this dire need of again of bringing back that knowledge. But how did that happen? I mean, who did that? So of course, in history, we always have this graph when something is at its peak, and then there is a decline, and then suddenly there is another peak. Again, there is a decline. You know, this is also applicable to human emotions or whatever we go through. So all this, you know, all these disciplines are related very much with each other. These proportions, as the video said, they were found in nature. They were decoded, rediscovered from past manuals. And there are a few institutes in the entire world that are working on this huge wealth of knowledge. Because it did not, I mean, if it began from the curiosity that how, natural elements are in some sense of balance. So where does that balance comes from? And that's where the question of, the question of curiosity started to develop in thinkers and scholars. And that's where all these diagrams came up. And that's where, they started using them in architecture variously. So it so happened that, I'll not go over this right now, but I think yes, because so these golden proportions are very much closely related to the concept of unity that I was talking about in Islamic tradition. And because this concept of unity also comes in many other traditions, in Christianity, even in Hindu traditions, even in other Southeast Asian traditions, even in Judaism. So a lot of these traditions are talking about this concept of unity, this principle of truth, or getting closer to the truth, as Professor Keith Critchlow mentioned. That relatedness or relationship is the key to understanding what golden mean and golden meaning is all about. To strike a golden mean relationship is obviously to get much closer to the truth, that is closer to unity, which in turn can indicate the unity of the whole universe. So, these concepts of universal metaphysics were starting to emerge with these mathematical proportions, and that is why they were heavily getting used in a classical Greek period. But it so happened that, as I told you, that everything was the whole knowledge got depleted and it was never used then. So what happened? Now we are here in 10th century. In 10th century, there's this Abbasid Caliphate period, followed by the Umayyads. That is, these are the second major caliphate that was spread wide across, that is after Prophet Muhammad. And the remarkable thing that they discovered is, of course, they had Alexandria, that is Egypt, a part of Egypt, under their control, and Alexandria had huge libraries. When they annexed Alexandria, they came across these libraries, a huge amount of knowledge written by Plato, Socrates, Pythagoras, and several such other Greek thinkers and scholars, but they were written in Latin. They couldn't read. So they hired, the caliph, the Abbasid Caliph, they commissioned these translators who could translate from Latin to Arabic. And there was this very fine scholar, or rather, I would not say scholar, but of course now he's termed a scholar, but he was a profound mathematician at his time. He was a profound astronomer at his time in 10th century. He was from Persia, settled in Damascus, and he when he came across these manuals, when they were translated in Arabic, he figured that there could be more that could be added to this knowledge, not only golden proportion, there are several other proportions. So we cannot say that, you know, all these proportion systems have come from Greeks only. Nobody has that authority on this knowledge. Knowledge has traveled and it grew over time. And then it started getting applied in its various capacities to whichever time period it belonged. So this mathematician, astronomer, his name is Abul Wafa al-Buzjani, and he adds to that knowledge tremendously. We have his written manual, and he had written a great work, which of course there are many astronomical figures and diagrams, but there is a very substantial production by this man, by Abul Wafa al-Buzjani, a book on those geometric constructions which are necessary for a craftsman. You might wonder, if it is for craftsmen, how is it related to architects? But this, you know, this manual was referred by architects too, because it talked about proportions, and architects, I mean, these proportions were not only referred by the craftsmen for producing all these kind of Islamic geometric patterns and calligraphic, even the calligraphy has a pattern. Calligraphy has a geometry to it. It's not just the whims and fancies of a calligrapher. It doesn't adhere to that. Architects would also refer to this, and they started using these proportions in their architecture. And that's where we see a sudden boom of this knowledge coming in Islamic traditions and several Muslim monuments. He discovered not only golden proportions, as I told you, but he furthers this existing knowledge with other sacred proportional systems dealing with root 3, root 2, there is root 5, root 6, and it can go on till certain level. I'm not going to go into those details, but then I'm talking about that these proportion systems existed in right from these times, and they were getting applied. They were getting applied even in later in the Christian world, that is in the Renaissance period. But they were very superficially, you know, just the overall outline, overall compartment, overall grid of the building. That's it. A lot of depth. Depth of knowledge is resides in these proportions, because if it is applied only to the surfacial element, only to the facade, it doesn't serve the purpose. If it is applied only in the plan, it again doesn't serve the purpose. It has to be a rational, holistic whole, you know, of the spatial and the volumetric quality of the building, and not only just elements, doors and windows and things like that. Not just, it just doesn't limit to that. And if one does, that means these principles are not applied to its fullest strength. I mean, these principles, or rather the golden proportions, were applied, but then, as I told you, not in its fullest capacity, not in spatial and volumetric quality altogether. Sinan, of course, the video mentions that in paintings also, in Renaissance paintings also, we see that these proportions were applied. But what Sinan does is amazing, because he applies them in its spatial, volumetric, and to lots and lots of details, to the mukarnas that I was talking about. Even those are worked out in certain proportion, and these sacred proportion systems only. So, I mean, the question that how could he build these buildings, in a limited time period, the construction was so fast, and at the same time, all his buildings are phenomenally different from one another. I mean, of course, they look similar in first appearance, that is to an unconditioned eye, it appears, same. Someone would say same, that they look same. I mean, that is for an untrained eye. But the moment you start getting into the details of his buildings, you get to know that he employed proportions to a level that one cannot even imagine. This was never done earlier. So, of course, because of this these proportions, he could probably, this is my hypothesis, probably because he had worked out a certain proportion system, a certain way of approaching design, he could design several buildings in that limited time period of 50 years, wherein he must have designed buildings in several geographical locations wherein he couldn't even travel, like in Greece, in Bosnia, Herzegovina, in Bulgaria. He has designed monuments there as well, but he couldn't travel. But definitely his proportion system, his strict planned proportion system was so result oriented that he could manufacture these drawings every time very innovatively, where nothing repeats from one monument to another. So I think, there is a lot of study that goes in here. A lot has to be done. So this one...
Hello, ma'am.
Yes?
Ma'am, sorry to interrupt. We need to get done by 11 a.m.
Yes, sure. I know we have, say, about 3-4 minutes. I'm just winding up. Yeah.
Okay, ma'am.
So a lot of work has been done, a lot of work is going on, and I hope we arrive at even more solid conclusions on Sinan's work. So I'm just ending here at this poetry written by Rumi, because I think one can relate this with the interior, wherein he's talking about the Almighty as the eternal geometer. So he says, all this seeming together and tearing apart bewilders me. My mind reels at the variations of a formation and obliteration. The heart is a dustboard. He, the geometer of the heart, what a marvel of figures, numbers, realities, and names he inscribes. So I think I will end with that, stating that Sinan's work does. He definitely deserves celebration in our studies of history of architecture, and bringing two verses from his autobiography, where he says architecture is the most difficult of professions, and he who practices it must above all things be pious. An architect talking about piety is amazing. I've never heard of any architect talking about piety in architecture. Architects only talk about competition and you have to be best and things like that. But he's talking about piety. And then the other one is, I wish to become an architect that with my perfect skills, I should leave works of art in the world. So with this, I end my presentation. And if there is any question, please let me know.
So ma'am, before we head towards our Q&A, our principal Rupali H. Gupta ma'am would like to have a word.
Sure.
So, ma'am.
Hey. Hi, Nisha.
So nice to
you. You enthrall me every time, in every session of yours. I'm so glad you could give your time today. I will not speak much, but I have volumes to speak about you. And I have been telling students every now and then, every time when it is your topic and when it comes to Byzantine and Ottoman. And on that note, thank you very much for being here. We will get back to you on the email. Students have quite a lot of questions, but since we are running short of time, we would, just mail it to you, and I'm sure you would, we are looking forward for you to revert back. So if you can just spend some few minutes more.
Sure, yeah. I'll do that. And I'm so sorry to stretch it more, but then, the matter was so much that it was impossible to even compress it further.
Yes,
and I know who
yes.
my audience is, so I just didn't want it to to appear mouthful of words and something that everything is going above their head. So I was trying to be as...
It was perfect. It was perfect. I'm sure we are going to ask for more from you. You will soon receive a mail from us again and we will ask for your time again.
Thank you. Thanks a lot to everyone who paid their attention all throughout. Thank you very much.
Thanks. Kunal, you can conclude the session.
Okay, ma'am. So thanks a lot, respected architect Nisha Mewara, ma'am, for an enlightening and knowledge-gaining presentation, which took us on the right way and which we got to know many new things about the Ottoman architecture. So thanks a lot, ma'am, for this presentation and a heartiest thanks to all the participants for joining in for such a great session. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.